Hello everyone, and welcome to Vintergatan Wednesdays. Let's call Mr. PM Butterfly himself.
Ring, 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 ring.
What have you been doing since last week?
Basically, a lot of Excel work. It doesn't come natural to me, but I know I have to do it. What I actually want to be, Hannes, is I actually want to be a composer. I love to be a musician. I love to play live. But it's a composition of music that is closest to my heart. When Olivier from ID Acoustic reached out and we started to plan this proper music studio build together, that has been like a side thread that I've been so happy about because it's nurturing my composer, Martin, right?
I'm Olivier from ID Acoustic. The first part of the project was to understand Martin's need and how the room will be used.
Do you think that Martin's room has potential to be a great studio?
And the U-shape is pretty interesting because we have the idea is to have different sounds in the different parts of the rooms. When I first come to Martin's house, I found the machine is very bigger than I thought. So it's going to be a very good place to work and to record, but it's not very big. In big studios, you know, you have different rooms. You can have a drum room with a pretty reverberant sound, for example. You can have some voice booth with a very dead sound. There is not enough space in Martin's studio for that. So the idea is to have viable acoustics, so you can record anything you want with very different sound qualities. So from very reverberant to very dead, it's all custom made. This is not products that are readily available on the market. We are trying to mimic the machine mechanics on our panels. So with parts that can move and some steel frames and using the same wood and using some same materials, the studio will be really designed for the machine, yes.
A cool surprise was on your renderings, you made this into a recording room. I have it for storage, but when I saw your idea, I was thinking maybe I can move all this downstairs. Because when the Marble Machine is there and studio is there, here I can play guitar, here I can play...
Yeah.
So it's a really good idea.
Could be possible to have a very different acoustics there, from there.
Okay.
So you can record specific instruments. Or maybe I thought about the possibility to have a curtain there. Even when the curtain is there, you can open or close it to have different acoustics. This is a possibility and you will have different sounds. But if we don't have the curtain, then the changeable acoustics will limit.
Okay, we're definitely going to do the curtain. You've convinced me.
Here you are on the mixing position. And what is very important in this part of the room is to control what we call early reflections. This is the sound that comes from the speakers and will bounce on the walls or ceiling before hitting the ear.
Okay.
So we don't need and we don't want an unchangeable acoustics there. It doesn't mean so much.
Gotcha. You want to fine-tune it and then leave it like that.
Yes.
Yeah, okay, I understand. One of the coolest features is a diffuser designed with Duplo. It's an idea of
exactly.
yours.
Yes, I know you are a huge fan of all Lego things.
Yeah.
So I am. And I thought it would be very cool to make a great acoustic diffuser, a true acoustic diffuser, but using Duplo. We are working from 1,000 hertz to 5,000 hertz.
What does that mean? That's the frequency where you're going to diffuse.
Exactly.
What does a diffuser do?
When you have two different walls that are perfectly symmetrical, the sound can bounce between the two walls and almost forever.
Yeah.
Not really, but it's like what we call reverberation. When you put a diffuser in one of the two walls, then the sound will not bounce there. The diffuser will explode the sound wave in many little lost sound waves.
Yeah.
And this way, you don't have the feeling that you are recording in the bathroom or something like that. And you won't absorb the sound, so it won't be dead. It won't sound dead. It will sound very live and it will make the impression that the room is larger because of the diffusion.
And can you buy them in color? So can you buy all black?
It can be all black, yes.
Oh, that's great.
Or all white.
So you have some Sputniks with you. What is this?
we bring our acoustic measurement tools to measure the different acoustic parameters we need for the project. So basically, we have like a sonometer. This is a device that will record and analyze the sound from the different devices we have here, how the sound will reflect in the room, basically. And to make the sound to be recorded for that, we are using this dodecahedron. It's a very special speakers. You have a lot of speakers in all faces there. The purpose of this one is to have a perfectly controlled waveform over all the surfaces, so we can measure how the sound reflects on both the walls, the ceilings, and floor.
Vincent has set up the first audio measuring, and there's a measurement microphone here, which is exactly in the mixing position, and you're going to measure the two speakers. What is this measurement for?
It's to check the linearity of the room in order to understand the response of these loudspeakers here for this position of listening in this room.
Okay.
So it's the whole thing.
This axis is the time, and down here is the bass, and here is the treble.
Exactly.
And how does it look?
So from this first measurement, we can see that the frequency response is not linear at all, because we have differences around plus 10 and minus 10 decibels.
Ah, that's quite a lot.
That's a lot. And so we have to work on this frequency response and also on the behavior in the time to have something very smooth and very similar. To understand the causes of this response, we have to move the microphone 50 centimeters up, 2 meters and 10. All the differences we see in the three measurements correspond to the contribution of the floor and the ceiling.
Ah, cool.
This is the meaning.
Cool.
Theory can say a lot of things, but it's always interesting to verify the actual behavior of the room.
And the second part is more bass frequencies oriented, because there is a special effect in the low frequencies that is called room mods. And when you walk through the room, the low frequencies will not sound the same in every part of the room. If you are in the corner, the low frequencies will be very much higher. And if you are in the perfect center of the room, the low frequencies will be almost inexistent. We are rebuilding everything. Actually, because we want the acoustic to be very integrated in the room and not like panels put on the walls and everything. We want the acoustic to be perfectly matched in the room size and everything.
This week, Olivier and his whole team is coming on Wednesday. So I have been preparing for them. I've been taking down like the remains of the old bathroom. After all these hours in Excel and trying to teach myself how to think differently about the project, it was so nice to just take a sledgehammer and just, I obliterated that block of concrete. And today I'm painting, we're gonna paint the whole studio white and also make the wooden beams beautiful with black oil. So everything should be spick and span, ready for Olivier's team. And it's kind of funny that I removed my own acoustic treatment.
You had it up for a month. It was time now.
Yeah. I put the starry sky on the backdrop and everything, like, and all those. And now I just took them down. I've been thinking so much. Was that some kind of comforting project for myself? Was it procrastination, or was it because I wanted to learn? And the jury is still out regarding how much procrastination that project was, because I did learn how the room sounded with my treatments. Now I can compare. Like, now I know how the room can sound. So now I want Olivier and the team to make something way better than what I did. It's so nice now that we have the engineers who are doing things all over the world. The planning is happening here, but the real building and stuff is happening all around.
It kind of seems like you're doing this again.
Yeah.
Like, we have seen this before.
Yeah, good question. And I entered the video, I think, by saying I'm going to learn how to work organized. And I think I at least made four intros like that or four. I say four and show three fingers. That's the level of brilliance I am at right now. I am not feature creeping. I am not doing this to make it look cooler. It's first now when I put everything together that I notice problems. When the conveyor belt exploded, I was like, yeah, I can't just go put little patches on top. You know, when you have a rust damage on your car, you don't just go scrape some paint on. You take an angle grinder and you take everything off until you're down to the bare metal and you have to grind everything off. You weld a new piece of metal on, then you polish it and then you paint it. You can't just paint on top of the rust. And I think this is the moment I'm stopped painting over the rust and I'm taking the angle grinder and doing this right. My magnet programming pin system, I have to say it has been amazing, but I think it's accurate down to like 0.05 millimeters or something like that. The stud welded system from HPS, where they have a CNC machine that puts down studs on a big sheet, that will be so much more timing accurate. So that will give the machine the best possibility to play tight music.
We had a meeting with HPS, the company that makes the CNC stud welder. Now that it's getting more serious about making the plates more like tour ready and making the machine more tour ready, we had another meeting this week and we talked to them about how they can make the first calibration sheet for us. So I sent them the new test sheet today and I hope that they can produce it in the coming weeks and we can send it to Martin to mount it on the machine.
Hi, my name is Sebastian Janssen. Specifically for the Marble Machine X, I did conversion software from MIDI to laser cutting templates. Together with Marius, I'm now working with the new method that Martin has decided to use, that being the stud welded templates, to get that first batch out so HPS can weld those test sheets so Martin can try it out.
Why does he need this software?
The reason why it needs software is because you can compose on the machine itself by just plucking the fingers and playing some notes. But what if Martin wants to sit on his desk and compose a regular way with other instruments as well? I give the ability that he sits on his chair in front of the computer. Those digital notes I convert into physical plates that will be placed on the marble machine.
I talked to Tim Keller, who's responsible for the whole new CAD project.
Yeah, this is a monster project of monster projects. I think it's almost more difficult than the machine itself.
All right, so for the CAD project, what we're doing is, just like the Tiger King, we're going to be capturing the CAD model of the MMX, and then we're going to tame it. Then we're going to transform it into something beautiful so it can breed. We are going to capture the individual components of the Marble Machine X. Some of them have been developed outside of the larger CAD model. This is DFM, which is designed for manufacture. So we're going to find places in the Marble Machine where it can be made better and more efficiently. And that's going to allow us to actually build another Marble Machine. There's this idea, which is that if the Marble Machine is not robust enough to withstand any breakdowns while we're on the world tour, we might want to have a backup marble machine. It's not possible unless we do that kind of ground-up redesign.
And how are you working with the community on this?
We're going to delegate the hell out of this. We have thousands of parts. And so we're looking for people who have Fusion 360 experience and will have some sort of qualification process. There's a bunch of people already in the Discord server who volunteered to help. Because I think the best way to learn CAD, this is the way I learned, this is the way Martin learned, is just by drawing things that are interesting to you. So to the extent that we can, I want to make what we're working on visible and accessible. And if people want to just learn CAD by working alongside us, even if their models are duplicative or whatever, it's such a great way to learn that technology. And it's a useful technology for almost anybody. So hopefully we'll have people CADing alongside of us who aren't even if they aren't officially on the team.
But the best thing with this CAD project is that we can use the refined and improved CAD model to actually finish the current Marble Machine X, because there's a lot of tasks that I can't delegate because the CAD is not exact. If I say, can you do this? They say, yes, just give me the CAD files. And we don't have the CAD files. Since everyone is working on distance in this project, we really need this map of the machine to be true. So I'm very excited for the CAD project.
Well, it's time for us to do the most important part of the video. We need to go to the community corner. We need to have an intro for that as well.
Community corner.
Wow. We are professionals.
To help with composing music on the Marble Machine X, why don't you trigger the marble drops with solenoids controlled by a MIDI source? Like this. That way you don't have to change programming pins all the time while composing. I'm sure your mechanical engineers can figure out how to actuate the marble drops with the solenoids, and I would be happy to do the electronics, as my background is in industrial automation.
Ah, that's pretty genius, actually, I have to say. That's a really great idea. I have to spin the machine to make the marbles come up, but it's not the rotation of the programming wheel that plays the music. I can compose for the machine in MIDI. Actually, this could be really, really, really interesting. This could solve a big problem, because then I could sit and compose in Logic in my studio, make a song. I think this sounds pretty good. Then I could try it on the machine. I just hit play on the MIDI. I rotate the marble machine just to lift the marbles. And the solenoids would play my MIDI pattern. And I'm like, oh, I don't like that drum fill. I stop the marble machine. I go to the computer. I move the MIDI points around. I play again. And when I'm done with my MIDI, I send my MIDI to Sebastian, who's made this software already. He converts it to DXF. We send the DXF to HPS, who stud weld the programming plate. And there we go. So, Mikhail, thank you so much for the idea. If I understand it correctly, I think you're onto something great. And if this is a project I can delegate that you could maybe be project manager over, then I'm super happy if you want to be part of the thousand-armed octopus. So nice talking to you, Hannes, and to everyone watching this. Like, you're the true fans. You're like basketball fans who stays with the team even when they're losing. It's loss, 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 and a little win, but you're seeing that the team is working hard. Thank you so much for watching the Building Marble Machine X video series, and we're gonna be in the gym from 7 o'clock each morning to take home the championship gold in the end.
It's off season now, but we're coming back better than ever.
Exactly.
It's gonna be the comeback of the century. Take care, everyone, and see you on the next Vintergatan Wednesday.
Boom!